Welcome. We'll start with the economic survey volume 2. Now we have already covered volume 1. In volume 2 there would be 10 chapters. Most of the questions that would be asked would either be on the yojanas, the schemes, the latest amendments that have been talked about, which have been discussed here. So we'll be briefly touching each of those. And most of them have already been covered in separate videos, so we have the link wherever they have been covered. For the others, we'll be covering further lectures soon. Now coming on to this section, volume 2, there is lots and lots of statistics. So whenever you are writing a kind of subjective answer, these statistics and data can form a part of your answer. So what you need to understand is you have to substantiate your answers with some basic facts that we won't be discussing in the class, but these would be available as handouts in the Examrace current affairs section. So you can go through the graphs, the diagrams and the data there. Now, in India, we have been talking about India is one of the best performing economies for 2016-17 and with an average growth rate of around 7.5%. So that's a kind of decent growth rate, which is much higher than the other economies of the world. So that's one important thing. The other important thing is the growth is around 4% higher than the global growth rate. So that's again important thing to note. So India is performing well. Now initiatives like Make in India, where we are trying to bring in more developments in our own industries, would further accentuate this growth. So we have the various data for the real and the nominal GDP. Now the idea of GDP, GNP, the real and the nominal, we have discussed in our lectures on economics. So you can refer those for details on the terminologies. Now here one important terminology that we would be trying to understand is the concept of year over year and the reserve money. So those two are generally talked about when we talk about a kind of overview picture. So year over year growth means over the years what has been the growth and whether this growth has been accentuating the economy or not. The next is reserve money. Now the concept of reserve money could be understood by a kind of simple Venn diagram that we would help you. Now we are understanding two terms. The first is the monetary base and the second is the monetary supply. Now, we would be further discussing this in detail when we would be discussing our lectures on economics. For a brief idea here, under the monetary base, you would have bank reserves and the money in circulation. So this is money in circulation. This is the bank reserve and together they would form the monetary base. When we talk about monetary supply, it would be the money in circulation plus the checkable bank deposits. So checkable bank deposits along with the money in circulation will form your monetary supply. Now based on the monetary supply and the monetary base, we understand or we calculate the money multiplier. So under a money multiplier, it's simple, if you put it very simply, it's addition of dollar that has been created in the money supply by an additional increase of $1 in the money base, the monetary base. So if we are talking in terms of rupees, we would say it in terms of rupees, but that's a kind of standard way to understand the money multiplier. So that's a kind of additional increase of $1 or 1 rupee in the money supply when there has been an addition in the monetary base or the bank reserve and the money in circulation. So that's how we understand the multiplier, and this multiplier leads you to an important figure for your GDP and the growth rate. So we have the various statistics across the various sectors. Now one important finding here was the two sectors, one is the agriculture and the public administration, have contributed to 1/3 of the growth in the economy, and that is really very important. So these two sectors become primarily important. Now another reason why we say the growth in the industrial sector has declined, it's because of the credit growth. So there has been a kind of slowdown in the credit growth and therefore you have a decline in the industrial production that has been witnessed. under GDP and its components, we talk about the GDP, the real GDP, the GVA, that's the gross value addition, and we also talk about the private final consumption expenditure and the government final expenditure consumption. So under consumption expenditure, we break it into two heads, the government and the private, and that's the kind of final consumption that we talk about. And both these consumptions have increased over the period. Now, the next important thing is this private final consumption expenditure is one of the major drivers of GDP, because in 2016 and 17, it contributed to nearly two-thirds of the total GDP growth. So our main focus here becomes the private final consumption expenditure. The next is the savings and the investment. So here we have a graph that shows, a chart that shows the change in the investment rate over the years and the saving investment ratio, the gap that has been declining over the years. Now, it is attributed to various factors. It's because of difficulty in getting environmental clearances, the industries or the investment rate has declined. Then you have problems of infrastructure, problems in acquiring land and developing in a new setting. So all those affect the saving and the investment setup in India. Now the next is the savings are channelized into bank deposits, life insurance funds, mutual insurance, shares and debentures, and their share or their proportion has considerably increased over the years. After the demonetization, we had a phase of remonetization, and that remonetization phase was indeed slower as compared to the previous growths. So we have the charts here. Some of these charts could form a kind of good support for your answer writing. So that section that we are talking about needs to be improved. Now under public finance, we specifically focus on GST. We have covered a detailed lecture on GST which could be referred. Over the years, what we have seen is the direct tax collection is now on track, so that has increased. The non-tax revenues have underperformed. The non-debt capital receipts and the proceeds from disinvestments are now doing well. So those are some of the things that we have been talking about. One important happening over the years is we have advanced the budget cycle, and that has led to progression of the central expenditure and more allocation and judicious allocation of the funds to the proper channels or the proper ministries. So definitely advancing the budget cycle has led to a positive impact on the economic growth. The next is we talk about the WPI and the CPI, that's the consumer production index and the wholesale price index, the consumer price index and the wholesale price index. So consumer based price index based inflation has declined in nearly all the fields, but the sharpest decline has been witnessed in the field of foods and beverages. Now the extremities of each are very, very important to understand. Similarly, the remonetization we have already talked about, how this has brought us favorable effect on the year-to-year growth and the reserve money ratio that we have already talked about. The next is the imports have declined, and this decline is due to reduction in the value of imports of the crude oil and the petroleum, more focus on Make in India opportunities, development mainly in the sectors of defense within India. The next is balance of payment. So this is a kind of balance between the exports and the imports. So what we are registering is a kind of balance of payment situation that has been changing since 2013-14 and 17-18. And this surge in the imports is mainly in the sections of gold and oil prices that have increased. So there is something where we are paying more. Then you have a section on invisibles. So invisibles is basically the service sector or the net private transfers that are being seen, and that has seen a considerable increase over the years. The next important thing we talk about is exchange rate. So in the last few years, rupee has been relatively more or less stable at the same price versus the dollar that we consider as a kind of standard for us. The next is trade policy. There have been two important developments. First is the midterm review of the foreign trade policy and the multilateral negotiations of WTO in December 2017. Both of these become very, very important. The multilateral trade negotiations for WTO could be a kind of short note or an answer for your mains paper. Then the midterm review of foreign trade policy is again very important, and this answer needs to be substantiated with lots and lots of statistics. So there are various incentives for exports from India, and they are divided mainly into two sectors, the textile sector and the service exports from India. The next thing that we need to talk about is the various sectoral growth. So we talk about agriculture. So in agriculture, we see that India ranks first with 9.6% of the net cropland area that we have. This is a report that has been given by USGS, the United States Geological Survey. And we have been working on various schemes like PM Fasal Bima Yojana, the Krishi Sichai Yojana, and so on. Now, all these schemes we will be covering separately in separate lectures. Many of those we have already covered when we have been going through the lectures on Yojana and Kurukshetra. So, to avoid repetition, we won't be covering each and every scheme again. We'll be just highlighting the various schemes. The next is the Index of Industrial Production. Now, CSO gives the Index of Industrial Production, and the base year for the Index of Industrial Production has been changed from 2003-4 to 2010 and 11 for the considering the fact the latest developments under 2017. So there has been a growth in the electricity generation at 5.2%, mining sector as well as the manufacturing sector. We talk about 8 core industries. So the 8 core industries have been given here, and these contribute nearly 40% in the IIP, that's the Index of Industrial Production, and a cumulative growth of around 4% has been registered in this. Besides this, we are also focusing on the sectoral growth. So we are addressing the issue of dumping of cheap steel imports from China, South Korea, and Ukraine. And government is trying to raise the anti-dumping duty and the custom duties on the same. Then we have the sectors for leather, where we have a kind of labor intensive sector. Gems and jewelry, where India is one of the largest exporter. Coming on to infrastructure, we have Bharatmala Pariyojana. We'll be covering that again in detail later. Under the Bharatmala Pariyojana, we have taken a separate class where we have already talked about the logistic performance index, which would be again the part of this section. And that's again very, very important, how India needs to improve on logistic performance index in order to have a strong infrastructure with it. The next is, under railways, we talk about broad gauging the lines, completing the electrification process. For the ports, we have the Sagarmala Pariyojana, we have already covered. For digital India, we have BharatNet and Digital India, that's basically talking about the digital economy in India. For civil aviation, we talk about Udaan, that's Ude Desh Ka Aam Nagrik. Under power, there have been two major schemes. The first is the Uday scheme, that is Ujjwal Discom Assurance Yojana, where we talk about the cost of power and the aggregate technical losses that have been registered in the power. The next is the Saubhagya scheme, that is Sahaj Bijli Har Ghar Yojana, which talks about last mile connectivity for electricity. Coming on to the services, out of the states, Delhi and Chandigarh are the top performing states, and Sikkim is the bottom performing state for service sector. India has remained the eighth largest exporter of commercial services in the world as per 2016. That's again very, very important. So some of the topics that have been important, we have tried to put those. Gender parity index, again very, very important. So women empowerment, women development schemes, under that you would have the gender parity index. So it reflects the disparity of girls versus the boys in access of education. The next is Swachh Bharat Mission, the rural version and the urban version. So we talk about Swachh Bharat Mission Grameen, where we talk about ODF, that's open defecation free regions. Labor reforms, very, very important. We are basically in the process of rationalizing the 38 labor acts and provisions for the existing 4 labor codes. Now, these 4 labor codes are codes on wages, codes on industrial relations, codes on social security and welfare, and codes on safety of working conditions. These are very, very important for your basic paper on GS. Otherwise, for the students from commerce and management background, this section becomes very, very important. So the details of the codes should be well versed for those candidates. The next is the India's development for sustainable development. So we talk about the sustainable development, and we India presented the first voluntary national review on the implementation of sustainable development goals. So that is the first nation that India has been. Now, under our report, we have focused on 7 sustainable development goals. Those are no poverty, zero hunger, good health, gender equality, industry and innovation, life below water, and the partnerships for goal. So these seven become very, very important. There could be a kind of direct objective question, which of the following sustainable development goal has not been the part of the voluntary national review of India. The next is access to sustainable energy. We have been already talking about the Uday scheme, the Ujjwala Yojana. Now we are talking about the Ujjala Plus scheme. The next is International Solar Alliance. That's very, very important. This International Solar Alliance is the first international intergovernmental organizational set up with headquarters in India. 46 countries have signed it and 19 countries have ratified it. Here are some of the developments that we have been talking about in that. There are 8 national solar missions for covering solar energy efficiency in various sectors. So it's agriculture, water, sustainable habitat, forestry, Himalayan ecosystem, and knowledge. So those are the 8 sections where we talk about the climate change and its implications. India has been working hard to maintain a good position because India is considered to be among the 6 nations which are most vulnerable to climate change. Disinvestment has been a major concern. So the major units are now being in the process of disinvesting. The next is the fiscal reforms for the advancing budget cycle that we have already talked about, and processing it a month before so that you have more expenditure that's available for the various ministries and the development that's seen. Again, we talk about the interest payment liabilities and the subsidy payments. Coming on to the next is the third chapter is the monetary management and fiscal intermediation. Now this chapter we specifically focus on the changes in the repo rate, the reverse repo rate, the bank rate. All these terminologies we have discussed when we have talked about the NCRT economics. So just go through those to understand the terminology. For now, there are two important concepts that we would be focusing on. The return over equity and return over asset. Now both of these, the return over equity, the ROE and the ROA, both are indeed important on understanding how a company is managing its capital. So if it is performing good, the management of the capital would be very nice. So that is how we try to understand the monetary systems in India. So we have the various developments, the developments of the government securities, how the government securities have changed, and the factors that have been affecting it, the performance of the banking sectors, the growth rate in the field of credit sector, the peer-to-peer and the aggregate account aggregators are the new categories that have been considered under non-banking financial sector. So this section becomes very, very important. Now this could be a kind of direct objective question, which are the new categories under non-banking financial sectors. So you have to pick out some specific sections from each of the chapters. The next is insurance sector, very, very important. Under insurance sector, the sector would be assessed on two bases: the insurance penetration and insurance density. Insurance penetration is the ratio of premium in a given year to the GDP. However, when we talk about insurance density, it's the ratio of the premium to the total population. So insurance penetration in India has increased from 2.7% to 3.4%. That's really very good. But for the other countries like Malaysia, Thailand, China, it's around 4%. So we need to move up to that level. The next is the price and the inflation in India. So we have already talked about how the consumer price index shows the various changes over the year, the current trends and the changes in the current trends that have been witnessed in the various sectors. So we are basically the drivers of inflation, and which sector has seen the highest inflation over the years has also been given here. So these are some of the charts that are really important to help you understand the state-wise distribution and the sector-wise distribution in the inflation. So inflation, when we talk about general inflation, it's more volatile than the core inflation due to more changes that could be seen in the general inflation over the relative prices, in the relative prices over the year. The next is the topic that we talk about is the efforts to contain inflation. Now this is very, very important. Now this could be a kind of short note or a long answer question where you have to bring around the following points: how we have a kind of price stabilization fund that works in, how are the actions taken against hoarding and black marketing, what are the schemes that have to be implemented, The government's promotion for minimum exports of certain units, the imposed stock holding limits for the stocks of the dealers in sugars and other aspects. So those are some of the important aspects. The fifth chapter and the sixth chapter are very, very important. Now under the fifth chapter, we talk about sustainable development goals. So these SDGs, you have the 17 sustainable development goals, and then we have the 169 targets that have to be achieved by 2030. However, under the voluntary national review, we have brought around a focus on 7 of the sustainable development goals. So those become really important. Now under this, we talk about one, that's the sustainable goal 11, that talks about urban India and sustainable development, which aims at making cities more inclusive, safe and resilient. So we focus on 4 pillars, that's the social development, economic development, environmental management and effective urban governance. These 4 pillars form the basis for the urban India and a sustainable India. We have already covered some of the aspects like the Smart City Mission, the Amrit Yojana and the various schemes for urban development in the separate lectures, so you can refer that. Again, Urban Housing and Habitat Policy 2007 is very, very important, don't miss it. Now we are also moving towards management of municipal solid waste, so that's again some of the major areas we are focusing on. A very recent step was SEBI has issued a notification where it talks about municipal bonds in India. So each city would have their own municipal bonds. That's a kind of new concept that's coming in. We have already worked forward for the Ujjwala scheme, where we talk about providing LPG cylinders to each and every households below poverty line. Now under that, if you look onto the statistics, on an average so far women used to spend around 374 hours every year simply to collect the firewood so that they could make a kind of processed food in the home. So this time now could be successfully utilized for some other work, and therefore we are trying to work more on value addition to agriculture and allied fields, because this data specifically works for the rural India. So when you have women in rural India who are now free from the burden of collection of firewood, they could invest them in the agro and agro allied activities, which could lead to increase in the GDP. So now we are also talking about Ujjwala Plus scheme, where we are talking about addressing the cooking needs of the deprived people who are not covered under the socio-economic caste census. The next is the Deen Dayal Upadhyay Gram Jyoti Yojana, where we talk about 100% electrification. Saubhagya scheme we have already talked about, which says last mile connectivity. So this is the picture for the rural households that have been so far electrified. The worst picture has been seen in the states with marked with red. So the Northeast and the UP Bihar region are the states that need to be given most emphasized. The next is buildings. A building energy efficiency program and the Energy Efficiency Services Limited has been implementing it. Now this talks about bringing in more ceiling fans, bringing in energy efficient ACs in government and private organizations. International Solar Alliance, as we have said, it's very, very important, so all the details should not be missed. Again, under the International Solar Alliance, there are 3 programs that are very, very important. It's scaling solar applications for agriculture, affordable finance at scale, and scaling solar mini grids. So these 3 are the top major priority programs for International Solar Alliance. Besides that, there are 2 more programs. One is the solar rooftop and scaling e-mobility and storage. So those are the areas, and this is a kind of journey of International Solar Alliance, how the various developments have took place over the year. We have examples from across the world, across the India. So for example, in Haryana, you have a Kalpana Chawla Solar Award that has been given to a woman solar scientist, and who has been doing extraordinary work in any of the countries across the world. When it comes to climate change, it becomes really very important, because now we are witnessing the extremes of rainfall and the extremes of temperature that has been seen, and India's effort is very, very important. So some of the key initiatives are the 8 global technological watch groups. Now these are in the following 8 areas: renewable energy technology, advanced coal, energy, enhanced energy efficiency, green forest, sustainable habitat, water, sustainable agriculture and manufacturing. So these 8 areas are very, very important. It could be a kind of direct question on these or a kind of indirect question that you need to cover. National Adaptation Fund on climate change, again very important, that should not be missed. Now we have been talking about the growth of the tree cover and the forest cover in India. We have already talked about the Science Express and the climate awareness. So how that has led to the younger generation develop an idea about science and a kind of climate awareness. The National Mission for Green Clean Ganga, listing of the green debt securities, very, very important. So those are some of the developments we have witnessed in the field of climate change. The next is, we have already seen how the climate risk index shows India among the 6 top vulnerable nations of the world. Under the 15th Finance Commission terms of reference, we have outlined that climate change is one of the major considerations that we need to focus on. So we need to work around the historical basis for the understanding it, and we need to work on the principle of equity, not equality, and differentiated but common responsibilities that could be seen. The next is the external sector. Under the external sector, we have talked about how India is doing good in the various sectors like merchandise. Then you have gold, jewelry, the trade deficit that has been seen so far. So the top 5 countries which have trade surplus balance are given here, and India has highest trade deficit with China. So those are the things we need to focus on and the focus areas where we could improve on our exports to those nations. So some of the statistics has been given here, that's really very important. So this chapter mainly focuses on the statistics that you need to talk about. Trade policy, we have already talked about the multilateral negotiations on WTO and the midterm review of the foreign trade policy that you need to cover on. The next important development is the ministerial conference and the India's stand. So India took about a kind of concessional decision. It worked on the principles of WTO for multilateralism. We are trying to underline the ideas that have been given in the Doha Development Agenda. So those are some of the India's perspectives. The Logistic Performance Index, we have already discussed how India has developed in that. There are various countries which are involved in the investigations with the major products that have been seen and which have been dumped from China. So these are the list of the nation, that's again very important. Foreign exchange reserve, India has no doubt gained successfully over the past years. When it comes to agriculture, more than 50% of the agriculture in India is dependent on rainfall. So good monitoring of the rainfall, R&D in the field of rainfall. We have seen how you have the climate prediction models that have come up. So all those becomes very, very important to decrease the risk of production and crop losses over the year. We have the statistics for the Kharif and the Rabi production and the dynamics of growth in the various sectors that have been seen. So the income of the farm sources have been changing over the years. We have in the recent agricultural sector, we are focusing on 30% budget allocation for women. We are trying to bring in more women-centric activities. As we said, around 374 hours per year are being saved from the collection of firewood. That energy could be utilized in some other sector, and that is what we are trying to do. We have understood the various cropping patterns. We are trying to work around the index of crop diversification. Now, crop diversification is important, specifically when we are focusing on climate change, because some of the crops are highly susceptible to climate change. So if there is a loss in one crop, it should not affect the economic output, and therefore we are working more on crop diversification. How we can use lesser fertilizers, organic fertilizers, and increase the productivity. So all those would be the focus. Then is the operational holding. So bringing in a kind of consolidation of land holdings or bringing in mechanization on the land holdings would again be a good idea. The seed production is again very good idea to understand which sector needs how much seed, and the soil health cards that we have already talked about. The next is mechanization. Under mechanization, as we said, Indian tractors are considered the largest in the world, and one third of the total global tractor production is in India. So India definitely has a huge agricultural workforce and an agricultural production or a base that should be efficiently utilized. So some of the statistics of the various schemes and the developments in the schemes have been given so far. Now, as we said, except coconut and urad, over the first half of the agricultural year, all the crops have registered a loss. So since these two were the crops that have registered a gain, we should work on more climate smart agriculture. So there are two approaches that we talk about. One is the climate smart agriculture, where we talk about transforming the agricultural systems for good support and food security. And the next is how the precision agriculture could be worked around. So that we have already discussed in our lecture on Kurukshetra in the month of February 2018, where we have talked about agriculture for prosperity. The next are some of the schemes include the e-naam, the Kisan credit cards, the interest subvention scheme. So we have the various copyright and trademark applications that have been in process. Food management is definitely a big issue, because now we are having a food surplus, and since we have a food surplus, we need to have cold chain storage mechanisms, and storage becomes a question, because if there is not proper storage, there would be loss of the productive item that has been generated. So open market sale scheme in the domestic market has also been given boost. In the industry sector, we are talking about the insolvency and the bankruptcy code, implementation of GST, recapitalization of banks. All of those we have covered in separate lectures, so we have the links there. You can simply go to those videos and understand these topics. We have seen how the CSO has revised the index of industrial production over the year, the developments in the industrial sectors and the various sectors, how they have been performing well. So this is the kind of rank of the ease of doing business and the different sections. We can see in which sections we have earned and in which sections we have declined over the years. So we need to focus or improve the rankings on those. Under Make in India, we are talking about the Make in India version 2.0. So we are working on the renewed focus for Make in India. Here are some of the focus sectors where we are talking about for the development of Make in India. The next is the intellectual property right, where we are talking about Creative India and Innovative India. The action plan for the Startup India, which comprises of starting with only 3 labor laws and 6 environmental laws. So those are some of the developments that have been seen. Development of MSMEs. So MSMEs we have exclusively covered in one of the classes of Yojana. So all the schemes, the subsidy schemes, the schemes related to MSMEs have been covered there. Textile is indeed important. So different sectors we have focused on how the ready-made garments have been working and how industries have affected those. So power loom industry and the effect on handloom industries. Gems and jewelry, we are already the largest exporter. So how can we set up new infrastructure, bring in more PPP, that's public-private partnership. Infrastructure is very, very important. And the infrastructure we talked about, the Sagarmala Pariyojana for the ports, Bharatmala for the roadway networking, the logistics index, the India's road density is again very important. So all those aspects we have already covered, and we are working on those again and again. So those are the sections that you need to cover. So Bharatmala, as we have already talked about, the various initiatives under Bharatmala. Then you have the infrastructure for the railways. So all the developments in the railways, the metro rail policy, the developments in aviation sector. So you have Udaan scheme, the regional connectivity, development of the unserved airports, liberalization of the air services. For the shipping, we are trying to reduce the GST. We are trying to promote the inland shipping. We are developing more coastal ports, minor ports as well as the major ports. So port development, the radio frequency identification system to reduce the time dwell and the transaction and ease the congestion process. Sagarmala Pariyojana and the waterways, the inland waterways transport system, we have already talked about. Telecom is an important sector. We have already been talking about BharatNet and the development of internet in the rural areas. Electricity, we have already talked about. Under energy conservation, two important schemes, the Unnat Jyoti by affordable LED scheme and All Street Lightning national program, where we talk about lightening of the streets. The next is petroleum and natural gas. We are talking about mapping of the sedimentary bases, refining capabilities, national gas grids, and the households that have to be covered under the DBT schemes. So the next chapter focuses on the India's service sector. So services have registered a growth over the years, but we are still on the process of becoming a kind of major service sector. There are few indexes that show you the standard or the improvement in the trade. One is the Baltic Dry Index. Now this is important because this is an index by a London-based company, and it is a composite of three index, that is Panamax, Cape Size, and Supramax. So that is the Baltic Dry Index, very very important, and it's a composite of which three index are again very very important. Then we have talked about the sector-wise developments under the service sector industry. So first is tourism. We have talked about how the heritage trail, medical tourism, Dekho Apna Desh scheme, tourism and governance have worked. We then talk about the IT sector and the business process outsourcing units. We focus on the real estate and the housing. We see how there have been amendments in the real estate investment trust, that is very very important. So some of the developments in the Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana, the credit link subsidy schemes, and the next very important topic is research and development. India ranks 60 out of 127 in global innovation index. That's very very important, and under this we are talking about innovations which have been lower than other countries like UK, USA, South Korea, and so on. We are talking on industry and university collaboration. We are talking more on patent applications, establishment of Atal Innovation Mission in various schools across India as an idea by Niti Aayog. We are talking about the agreements that have been signed between India and Israel for development of science and technology. For sustainable refrigerant technologies, we are bringing in new alternatives. We have to clear the pending intellectual property right applications and the various units that have been established under science and industrial research. So those are the developments that have been seen under science and development. Very, very important. The project of Entrix, that's again very important. The last is social infrastructure, employment, and human development, the very last sector where we talk about the social sector, the school classroom ratio, the participation, the pupil participation, the pupil to teacher ratio, how many teachers should be there per number of students. So all those have to be covered under this. So the ratio for the various states have been given. We are also focusing on gender parity index, that's the disparity between girls and boys in terms of education that we have already discussed above. We have focused on the labor reforms, the four codes that are existing, and we are working on those. The next important section is the initiatives under the government. So you have the Minegra scheme where we talk about 100 days of minimum employment guarantee. Then you have the Maternity Benefit Act that has come for the females. Again, you have the various political empowerment for the women, bringing them into the panchayat system or the local bodies is again an important initiative. We have schemes like Nayi Roshni for leadership development. Under health, we are bringing in more expenditure. We are incurring higher levels of out-of-pocket expenditure on health, which impacts the other sectors. So therefore, prioritizing health becomes very, very important. So Clinical Establishment Act and the Clinical Establishment Rules 2012 regulate the clinical establishments. We have the National Health Mission that we have talked about. Then the various developments under MCI, the amendments of the MCI, and the shift of the MCI to a new body is again important. The next is disability adjusted life years, which is known as DALYs. It is basically the sum of the years of potential life loss due to premature mortality that has been seen. So the impact and the significance has been discussed here. The next are the schemes like integrated child development, where we talk about Anganwadi, adolescent girls, child protection. Then we talk about the Pradhan Mantri Matru Vandan Yojana, the National Nutrition Mission that has been recently established, the Ujwala Yojana for the LPG connection that we have already discussed. So these are some of the major things that we have focused, and we need to work more on these issues or these chapters that have been discussed on the economic survey. As we said, three of the chapters are very important, chapter 5, 6, and 10, that you need to cover exclusively for volume 2, Economic Survey. We'll be covering some of the specific yojanas that we have talked about here and have not been covered in our general studies lectures. So stay tuned for more updates. If you have any doubts, you can leave those as comment below the video. Have a very good day ahead.